Okay, there we go. Good morning, everybody that got washed up here to church. We're glad that you are here. Hope everybody had a great week. And we're just going to go right into announcements. On next week's bulletin, we'll have this. The website address. It is also www.thelighthousechurch.net. That is published now and ready to go. Please go and check it out. It looks really awesome. Lots of information and pictures, and it looks great. And we're happy to have that done. Scott is doing still on your Kingdom Come series. This week is, what is the judgment seat of Christ? And if you look in the middle of your bulletin, you'll see that we have some topics still to come. Next week is Mother's Day, so we'll just take a break from that series for Mother's Day, and then we'll get right back into it. The youth kids, they are learning the characteristics of God. And this week is God is Faithful from Jeremiah 3, 1 through 26. It starts at 5 p.m., but tonight's going to be a short youth because we have worship night tonight at 6 o'clock. We're just going to come have a great time. If you have any questions on that, please ask Hector or Jada. Other than that, we'll see you at 6. Senior Saints is this Thursday at 11:30. We've got Sloppy Joe's, chips, coleslaw, peanut butter brownies. That's always a great time. 11:30, come out here to the church and have some lunch. Good news, Jan had surgery and it was successful. She's recovering right now at the hospital. They just asked for no guests, please, while she recovers, but she did have a successful surgery, and keep praying for Jan. So hopefully we'll see her here soon again. Bible study will be put on hold this week. Scott and Lisa are going to be gone, so we will pick that back up the next Wednesday. Okay, we have a sign-up sheet here. We've been throwing out kind of an option for a mass communication and text setup where if you want basically to put your name and your phone number or email, if something were to arise or prayer requests, we can get this information out to anybody that is on this list that would like to be part of that. We want to see who's interested, how many are interested before we take the leap into it. So here's the sign-up sheet we'll pass around. And that is just if you guys want to be part of it. If not, you know, don't worry about it. But we'd like to move forward with that so we can just relay information a lot quicker to a bigger crowd. So, also, guys, that's all we had for announcements. Keep Jan in your prayers, any other prayer requests. Tonight at 6 o'clock is worship night. Come out. We'll have a great time. It's supposed to stop raining, so we'll see everybody at 6.
Hey, good morning, everybody. Doesn't Missy do a great job on all these fancy things up there? She puts those up there, and you see it, the visual. I'm a very visual-minded person, so I see it stands out to me. Anyway, she does a great job with that, even as the announcements we see every Sunday. So, praise team, want to come on up, and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let's stand in the building. Gracious Father, we thank you for everything. And yes, even the rain, and I thank you for everyone that's here, that's been faithful to your house. I pray you bless them, Lord, and give them rewards beyond this world. Father, even today, I pray that this service be as a glory to you, every part of it, and that you open our hearts to receive and be ready to worship. May we truly see the light, even in the darkness, and may we glorify you each and every day. And even now, as we sing corporately, Lord, what a privilege is to raise up glory to you. We give you the praise, Lord. We also pray for healing, continued healing of Jan in the hospital, Lord. I pray it would be radical healing that would take place. And all those that are hurting, the Ripple family, a loss of a person in their family, I pray your comfort upon them. Lord, I pray your continued blessing on all those that are hurting, and also your continued blessing as we shout from the mountaintops. May we give you the glory. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
So aimless, life filled with sin, I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow in sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Just like a blind man, I wandered alone. Worries and fears I claimed for my own. Then like the blind man, that God gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. So happy, no sorrow in sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I was a fool to wander and stray, but straight is the gate and narrow's the way. Now I have traded the wrong for the right. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have grown, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars have flown, I'll fly away, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away in the morning. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away. A land where joy shall never end, I'll fly away, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away in the morning. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly.
What happens after this life, and even when we pass away or the rapture, what's going to be happening next. But I'll fly away. Gravity's not going to hold us down anymore. I get tired of that gravity, don't you? Holding us down, weighing us down. All that, we're going to be set free and we'll fly away. What's that going to be like with the flying away? My imagination's running away with me even this morning. I have a visual of a Superman with a cape. Wouldn't that be cool? Flying along. But we'll fly away. Gravity's not going to hold us down. Superman's got nothing on us. Right? Because we know the man, and his name is Jesus Christ. He is our Savior. And Superman has nothing on him. Because Jesus is our Lord and Savior, and he, because what he paid for us, we can fly away. Let's take a few moments. Just sit down for a few moments while I read Scripture. And it's taken from Matthew chapter 6 and verse 21. It says, verse 19, to start there. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Isn't it amazing how we want to amass so much treasure on earth and we want to protect it? Hey, we even have alarm systems in churches now, right? Even have one here. And because we were broken into, you know. And months back, about a year or so ago, I lost track of time even. And you know, it's sad. You think about that being broken into. You feel violated. I remember coming in that morning and the door was open on the side door, flying in the air. What was going on? And they had jammed it and come and broke into our church. They had taken a few items. You know, some of the things that they took candy out of the children's room. Yeah, they threw that camera and right at the side door, and for some reason they must have left quickly. We still are using it today. They took a guitar, an amp, a few things like that. But you know what? I really feel for them. My first emotion is I get upset with them, right, because they took some stuff, right? That was the church's. But then I felt sorry for them. Right? Because if this is all they've got and if this is all they're looking for, because we are higher than that, right? And we amass treasures beyond anything they can take. And the reality is this, is that we have a broken world that are looking for treasures. They're looking and they're even going to places that aren't their own. But hey, guess what? We have a treasure in heaven that no man can take. No one can break through and steal that from you. We serve a risen Savior that has paid the price for you, and we are here today celebrating him. And even in our act of worship as far as collecting of our offerings and our tithes. Did you know that's an act of worship? And that we have opportunity to give. And you know the Scripture says we're to give cheerfully. And what that means is you realize that your treasure is more than what this earth has to offer. And all that stuff's going to burn anyway, right? And it's stuff that you've accumulated. You may have worked hard, and great that God gave you the ability to work so hard, but still, he gave you the ability. So we know this is an opportunity, and it's an act of worship for you to be able to give back, to give into the Lord in your time, you're here, your presence, but also your monies that he has given to you. You know, it's been said, all the church ever wants is my money. Hey, if that's the way you feel, keep it. You're the one that's missing out. Because you can't outgive God. Can someone say amen? You can't outgive God. And then God even says in this area to test me. Test me to see how much I can bless you. Man, how much the Father can bless you. So this is an opportunity for you to worship, even in giving, and also a chance for you to fellowship with one another. And during our meet and greet time, and if you see someone across the way you haven't spoken to for a while, hey, run over there and meet them and let them know that you appreciate them being here and love on one another and give you opportunity to also give back to the Lord in your tithes and offerings. We have two boxes in the back and also offering plates in front to give you opportunity to worship God in your tithes and offerings today. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we receive this today. We pray that you would be, we would give cheerfully, Father, and honor you even in worship of our tithes and offerings. Father, I pray that every penny, every dollar, anything that's given, Father, that would be to your glory, that we as a church would use it wisely as to in your kingdom. and that we would bring lost souls before you to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for every person that's here. May they be blessed, and may we worship you, Father, and may we encourage one another, and may we have fellowship with one another. We love you, God. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's take a few moments to greet one another.
So how's everyone doing this morning? Everyone dry now? Is that all right? Just stand and just worship with us this morning, and just let's just praise the Lord.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love laid away to let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remained. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, is over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he paid for me more. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began, oh, your grace so is over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Darkness rejoiced as the new heaven has gone. But when Jesus arose with our freedom in hand, that's when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over. You have made me new, now life begins. Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sin.
You are our Lord, our Savior. You are Lord of all. Father, we submit to you. We sacrificially praise you, Father. No matter what's going on in this life, Father, we are yours. Lord, you deserve every ounce of praise we can give. And Father, we honor you. We praise you. And I know today, Father, with the storms going on, it's easy to be tired, wore out. But God, we give you every ounce we have. We give you glory and praise. You are amazing, God. You are our King, our Lord, our Savior. Father, we honor you. What a beautiful name. What a beautiful name in the name of Jesus. We thank you, God, and praise you in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
spirit healed, your mind, your soul. You cry out and say, Jesus, touch me. There's power in his church. Come on, do you believe there's power in the name of Jesus? Hey, church, yell out, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. He is the King of kings. He is the Lord of lords. He's the Prince of peace. Maybe today someone needs some peace in your life. Maybe you've been stressing out. Maybe life's been difficult. Maybe financial. Maybe whatever. You know how it works financially, right? As soon as you get a big debt, another one comes along. That's the way that works. Come on. And you cry out and say, look at the checkbook and say, there's not much there, but I do know one thing. Jesus is my King, and he's greater than my finances. He's greater than anything you're facing. Sometimes we worry about tomorrow. What are we going to do? Many are graduating in school, moving on to the next grade. You're like, I'm concerned what that's going to be like, or maybe changing schools. I'm going to tell you, say Jesus, because he's already there, and he'll prepare the way for you. He'll show you. There's no more worry, no more anxiety. You just say, Jesus, show me the way. Maybe you're going home today and your home hasn't been healthy. Maybe you've been struggling. Maybe there's been strife in your home and difficulty. And before you go home today, you go to that front door, you anoint that door, you say, Jesus, Prince of Peace, I need you today. I want peace in my life. I want peace in my heart. Jesus, take control of my house. Take control of my life, because there is power in the name of Jesus. Sing it one more time. Power in the name of Jesus. Sing it like you mean it, church. There's power in the name of Jesus.
Name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing.
As a church, we corporately cry out to you. Say, Jesus, have your way in our heart. Have your way in our mind. Heal our minds. Heal our hearts. Heal our bodies. Father, we cry out and say, Jesus, have your way in this church. Spirit of God, move freely as you wish. Let us worship you truly in spirit and in truth. Today, Lord, we cry out the name of Jesus in the literal storm that's even going on. Lord, what can touch us? Even a tornado has no place in the name of Jesus. Even the winds obey you. Father, let us embrace your peace. We honor you, and we praise you, God. Lord Jesus, we cry out to you. Have your way today, Father. Lord Jesus, Father, Lord Jesus, praise you, Jesus. Let's just take a few moments.
Someone needs to cry out victory today. Maybe you've been struggling with whatever it may be. Whatever it may be, and you're feeling overwhelmed. And you're tired. And you need to cry out victory. The sound of victory. The sound of winning. The sound of overcoming. The sound of power in the name of Jesus. If you need to shout victory, the victory cry, shout it in Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
anyone else wants, shout praise to Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Father, even today as our kids will be dismissed, I pray, Lord, your blessing on every child. I pray, Lord, that they hear your word that's been presented to them by their teachers. Touch the teachers, Father. Give them words to speak into our precious children. Father, even today, even Christy, Lord, is not doing well today. I pray, God, for Christy. I pray, God, you bless her, Father. You bless her, Lord, and bring healing into her body and her mind. And Father, even today, as we go into your word, I pray, God, Spirit of God, you move through us, on us, in us, and reveal to our hearts and minds, and let us have ears to receive what you have to say to us today. We love you, and in Jesus' name we pray, amen. Children's church and preschool are dismissed at this time.
Well, good morning, church. Good morning. It is very good to see you. And I do pray that God reward your faithfulness. That God reward your faithfulness. That you came to the house of the Lord and you looked out that this morning. You may have looked at the forecast. How many of you check the weather like I do? I check the weather. And you know why I check it frequently? Because it keeps changing all the time, right? What I like is when they say, there was a 41.25 chance of rain today. It's like 41.25% chance of rain. Come on, you can't get the 40% right, let alone the 1.25 additional. But it sounds very official, right? Someone's in charge. I'm going to tell you, I have the privilege of proclaiming the name of God. He's in charge, right? He knows the weather. He knows what's going to happen. Hey, I firmly believe, not to scare anyone, but even if we were to look out those windows and saw a tornado come at us, you'd go like, oh, my word. But do you believe God can have the tornado raise up right over us and go by? Yeah. I believe he can. He's the God that's even over the storms. So that's the kind of God we serve today. And I just want to say it's great to see you. And I want to encourage you and let you know God is God and he's in charge. And just keep running after him radically. I like that word radical. Radically running after him. You know what? It's going to be okay. We still face things, but it's going to be okay, right? So if you'll turn your scripture to 2 Corinthians 5, verses 1 through 11. 2 Corinthians 5, verses 1 through 11. I was studying the book of Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, that is, and I feel like that's a place where I want to go after we finish this series because it's an amazing book, and this chapter is amazing. I like to just preach on this chapter, but I have a topic I really feel impressed to talk about today in our series. But we'll be looking at 2 Corinthians 5, verses 1 through 11. You might also mark your fingers so you get there to Luke chapter 19 and verse 11. Luke 19:11. You can put your marker there and get ready because we'll plan on going there a little later. But today, to start off with, we're reading from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. All right? 2 Corinthians 5, verses 1 through 11. It says this, "For we know that our earthly house, this tent, is destroyed. We have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed with our habitation, which is from heaven. If indeed, having been clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we who are in this tent groan, being burdened, not because we want to be unclothed, but further clothed, that mortality may be swallowed up by life. Now, he who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who also has given us the Spirit as a guarantee. I like that word guarantee, don't you? He's given us the Spirit as a guarantee. So we are always confident, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith and not by sight. We are confident, yes, well, pleased, rather, to be absent from the body is to be present from the Lord. Therefore, we make it our aim, whether present or absent, or to be well-pleasing to him, for we must all, everyone say all. I should say all say all, right? For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, all of us, that each one may receive the things done in the body, according to what he has done, whether good or bad. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are well known to God, and I also trust are well known in your consciences. How many of you have ever slept in a tent? Yeah? How many of you have vowed, I'm not sleeping in a tent again? I shouldn't say vowed. I don't plan on it in my lifetime. Yeah, there we go. There we go. You know, you sleep in a tent, and you put yourself within the canvas feeling like you are safe. The varmints can't get you in that tent. Isn't that amazing that they can't see you, but they can sure smell you? Anyway, a tent. And the question is, how is the scripture starts off here saying our body is just a tent. And if you've been in a tent, you can relate to how fragile that is. And how many of you know that it's imperative you anchor your tent well, right? Have you ever been in a tent in a storm? Yes. This thing, and you realize, oh my word, what have I done, right? Oh my word, what have I done? Yeah, we slept in tents, and at least I have a story about a tent in Colorado, and that was a cold night. Woo! So we remember that. But I was thinking of another story. My brother, actually, who was older than me and far wiser, I don't know about that, but anyway, older than me, and him and his wife have four kids. Now they're all grown adults, what have you. But they used to be a tight-knit family of six, right? They get ready to go on vacation. Each one has their assignment. You get this, you get this. And they would travel and use a tent. They would stop at a campground and put up their tent, right? So each one had their assignments. Well, someone was important to get the tent, right? Because after all, that's important. And then, you know, his wife, Laura, would probably get the food and so forth, so forth. Everyone had their assignments. How many of you know it's important to fulfill your assignments, right? They get to their first campground, and they pull in there, they pay the money for the campground, and they go to set up the tent. And they realize they had the tent, but they didn't have the things to keep it up. No staves, no nothing, nothing to hold the tent up. Someone had dropped their assignment. And then what do? It was your assignment. Yours was yours. Doesn't fix anything. You've got a tent. You pay for a spot. You have no way to hold it up. Well, my brother can be a little bit redneck. I can be that way too. But so he came up with the idea that, hey, we have a tree in our lot, so we'll just fasten this tent to the tree. So they literally took rope and fastened their tent to a tree. And can you imagine just how that thing looked? A family of six in this tent that's just held up by one limb up in the middle. Meantime, there are probably $250,000 campers all around there. And I asked my brother, did you please hide your Kansas license plate, please? Because how that looked, you know, and it's important, all right? And so even though we're a tent, you need to have sort of a firm foundation. You need to have some structure to our tent. Or else we'll find ourselves in the same way. Because this is a very fragile tent. And, you know, even later in Scripture, we'll talk about it. We have a responsibility to take care of this body, right? So the question would be, how's our tent anchored? What are you fastened to? What structure are you living your life? Otherwise, you may be a tent, but you're flopping and moving with every wind of doctrine, every wind that may come your way, right? Do you need some structure? But it really brings a reality to how fragile we really are. We are, the Scripture says, Paul was a tent maker, by the way, so he knew what he was talking about. He said, your vessel, what we see, is merely a tent. That when we do pass away, there's a change that takes place, because your soul, whom you really are, your soul, your mind, your spirit, will live forever. You are inhabiting a tent, a shell. That's who you are. So when we pass from this life, we merely leave our tent behind. That's how that takes place in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. But here's the thing is, how do we have any resolution? How do we, Pastor, you're saying that we change from this life to the next in the moment when we pass away. They leave this tent behind and we pass away. How do I know what I know I know? How is it that I mean, after all, I don't always, I'll put it this way, I don't always feel saved. I mean, I struggle because this flesh, this tent, and this body sometimes struggle with this world. So you're telling me that when we change over from life to death in that moment, you're telling me that I will go to be with the Lord in heaven. How do I know that? Well, in Ephesians 1:13, it even says, we're sealed by His Spirit. The Scripture we just read, and also in this one, it says, we have a guarantee. Now, my friend, how many of you have bought a car, a vehicle, a house, whatever it may be, and it has a guarantee with it, right? Guarantee. And then you start, 31 days later, you bought a used vehicle. 31 days later, something goes wrong. And you think, okay, I'm going to take this back to the dealer. And then you take it back, and he says, let me show you the guarantee. It is a 30-day guarantee. And you are one day past, so not happening, right? And then even if it's 29 days, they try to maybe get out of it. Or you read it, it says, engine and transmission only. Well, my door fell off. How's that going to help me? See how the guarantees men make may not go as far as what we'd want. But I'm going to tell you, when God makes a guarantee, when God makes a promise, a guarantee, that you can bank on. Can someone say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So what we know in Scripture is that if you are a born-again believer, that you are sealed with the Spirit and you have a guarantee from God that when you, the moment you pass, you will be with the Lord. Yes. If you are a born-again believer, right? Amen? Do you believe you have that guarantee? I mean, you do have it in writing. It's right here. You have it in writing. A guarantee that you can literally, heavenly bank on. So with that being said, I'd want to know I'm saved, right? I'd want to know that I've received Christ. And the reality is when you receive Christ, the Spirit of God actually literally lives within you. You are what we call born again. Born from above. He lives in you, and that you can know, even facing death, that God will be with you until the very end. And you have that guarantee. Man, if you could bank on that, you can let that sink in. It takes away fear of even death. Because after all, it only gets better from here. We have just a tent, and it's going to change. So we know that guarantee is there. We know what's going to happen. But it says we walk by faith. Okay, I'm backing up a little bit. It says that the moment we're absent from the body, we're present with the Lord. That's a guarantee. That's in the scripture we just read in verse 6. It's a promise that the moment of your passing, which, by the way, other than the rapture take place, which I just assume take place even now, but other than that, we all 100% will pass. We will die. 100%. But at the 100% guarantee is the moment you pass, you are presently with the Lord. That's a promise. And that's in verse 6. We just read it. That's a promise you have. It also says in the scripture that we walk by faith, not by sight. We walk by faith and not by sight. Now, I'm a very visual-minded person. Even this PowerPoint slide I really like because you have two young people walking the path. And I thought about that, two kids walking it, and that's literal faith, right? There's no adult with them, and they're walking a path, and they're walking by faith, not by sight. They're trusting it's going to be okay. My friend, we need to also know that even though we haven't physically seen the Lord, that when you're born again, you are now walking by faith, knowing based on his promises, you will see him in his presence. Has any of you watched any part of the show, The Chosen? If you have watched that, I think season 4 is coming out right now. We've really been enjoying it because it gives us a visual. And it's not claiming to be a doctrinally 100% sound. Okay, they add in things. But still, it gives you a visual. What would it have been like to be one of his disciples to walk with Jesus? To walk with him. Think about it. He did miracles, right? We know he did miracles, and they were astounded by it. But he's claiming to be the Messiah. So this person standing right in front of you is God, the Messiah. That's hard to wrap your brain around, isn't it? You see him, so you're following him. Now, we know we have the Spirit of God within us, right? But the reality is we are walking by faith. We may not see him yet, but we will. That's walking by faith. You keep moving. The term here is walking, not standing still. Keep moving. There's times in life we get sidetracked, we get off course, but my friend, just like here, you see the path, you keep moving forward. Can someone say amen? You keep moving forward. Walk by faith, not by sight. Now, I'm a very sight individual. So it's sometimes hard for me because I can't see something. But the Christians, we bank and know the guarantee and the promises, and so we know this is true, so we keep living our life as we know where we're going. And we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes. Now, we're going to talk today about the judgment seat of Christ. The judgment seat of Christ. Here's a reality we're going to study into today, is this. One is that we've already discovered what happens at the moment we pass, the moment we die. We are instantly with the Lord, twinkling of an eye, instantly with the Lord, if you are a believer. If you are a believer. If you are an unbeliever, unless the rapture takes place, until the second coming of Christ. If you are an unbeliever, you will be holding until your judgment. We're going to talk a little bit more about that in a moment. But we will, all believers, stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Now, I kind of want to know, with that being said, sis, brother, we need to kind of know, what's that going to be like? You're going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ if you're a believer. If you're an unbeliever, you're going to stand before the great white throne later. Both will be judged. Well, does that mean we go before the great white throne? I'm sorry. No. That means we go before the judgment seat of Christ, and then I hope I can go to heaven. I'm going to be judged, and I don't. No, it's not like that. It's not like that. First, Jesus is the judge. Jesus is the judge. Here's an area I'm going to probably step on toes. I step on mine, too. Sometimes we think we are. Boy, that is. Sometimes we think we're the judge. When the reality, brothers and sisters, we will all be judged by Jesus Christ. Maybe we need to step back and do a little less judging. We talked about this Wednesday night even, about the times when we do step in. It's when someone is walking the wrong direction and we know they're leading to sin always has a price. It always leads to damnation and darkness. And if we can help a brother or sister get them back on the path, you could say you're helping them by judging what they're doing. But it's always in love. But we don't need to be judging other people that are believers too. Because after all, we will all stand before the judge, and his name is Jesus. He's the judge, and he's always the righteous judge. He's the right judge. We will stand before Jesus. So the question is, before the judgment seat of Christ, that believers, and I'm talking to, I pray, a house full of believers, what will take place? What's going to happen? Well, we know in John chapter 4, or chapter 5, verse 22 through 23, it says, "Moreover, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, that all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him." Jesus Christ is the righteous judge. He's the one that's chosen. He's the righteous one, and we'll all stand before him. So the question is, what's the difference between the judgment seat of Christ and the great white throne? Two judgments, two of them. I've even sometimes missaid them, even in this series, so we need to get this right. And there again, you're welcome to pull out a phone, take pictures of this, whatever you like to do. And if you need me to smile, I'll smile. No. So here we see the differences between the judgment seat of Christ and the great white throne. You'll read about the judgment seat of Christ in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 2. No, chapter 3, rather. 2 Corinthians 5, we just read. Also Romans 14. You'll read about it. Okay? It is the judgment of believers. So the judgment seat of Christ is the judgment of believers, where we receive rewards based upon the things we've done for Christ. Where your life will be evaluated, and everything you've done for the kingdom, we're going to read another scripture about that a little bit. Everything you've done for the kingdom, you will receive rewards. Contrarily, the great white throne is another judgment. It is in Revelation 20 and possibly Matthew 25, 31 through 46, it talks about it. It is the judgment of the unbelievers. Everyone will stand in judgment. Believers will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. The unbelievers will stand in judgment before the great white throne. Everyone will stand in judgment. Now, the great white throne is for the unbelievers, and it's punishment based upon the rejection of Christ. Anyone, and we know many, that have rejected Christ, have rejected him, they will be standing in judgment. In a few weeks, we'll talk about that one, okay? So that's the unbelievers before the great white throne later, but right now we're talking about what could happen, hey, even tonight, is the judgment seat of Christ. So we're going to talk about what takes place there. We know Scripture even says in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17, that the time has come and judgment must begin at the house of God. Judgment must begin with you. Must begin with the house of God. The judgment, in the words previously spoken, judgment will begin with the house of God, refers to the judgment of God passes upon those who come before his throne in the last days. God will judge you. Okay, we're going to talk about what that means in a few moments. So what that means is, the question is this. Does that mean we stand before the judgment seat of Christ and we go like, I hope I can go to heaven? Is that what it is? I guess. No, it is not. Amen. Someone just amen that one. I like that. So it's when we stand before, what is it? Well, first we must know this. In 1 Peter 2, verse 24, he, Jesus Christ himself, bore our sins on his body, on that tree, so that we might die to our sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. We know that he died on a cross and took our sin upon that cross. And if you receive Christ as your Savior, he pays the price you cannot pay. And he overcame even death. And as a result of that, he paid the price you cannot pay. So when you stand before the judgment seat of Christ, it's not your sin debt that's being evaluated, because it's already been paid, right? If you're a believer, let this soak in. If you're a believer, your sin debt has been paid. Your past, your present, and your future. So when you stand before the judgment seat of Christ, it's not your salvation that's judged. Let that soak in. It's not your salvation, because you can know the guarantee of your salvation that you are saved. You can know that, brothers and sisters. And if you do not know that, you need to take care of that today. Can someone say amen? Amen. You need to take, mark my words, you may take care of that today, because it may be today, it may be tonight, that you literally, in the rapture, will be ushered before the judgment seat of Christ. Okay? Therefore, because we know this, in Romans 8:1, there is now, therefore, no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life, set us free from the law of sin and death. So we know this. Let this soak in. I'm building a foundation. Believers, be excited, be encouraged that you will stand before the judgment seat of Christ, but there is no condemnation on you. That would ought to say amen. No condemnation? Your sin debt is paid? Man, that ought to be shouting grounds. We ought to be worshiping God right now. Isn't that great to know your sin debt is paid? You have a guarantee that when you pass, I know where I'm going, and I'm going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and it'll be the blood of Christ on me, and I am saved, and there is no condemnation. The judge, Jesus Christ, will not condemn you. So what goes on at the judgment seat of Christ? Well, it says our works will be tested by fire. If you turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, please. 1 Corinthians 3. First Corinthians 3 and verse number 5. Who then is Paul, and who is Apollos, but ministers through whom you believed? As the Lord gave to each one, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gives the increase. So then neither he who plants is anything, nor he who waters, but God who gives the increase. Now he who plants and he who waters are one, and each one will receive his own reward according to his own labor. Each one will receive his own reward according to your labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building, according to the grace of God which was given to me as a wise master builder. I have laid the foundation. Another builds on it, but let each one take heed how he builds. Build your life. Take heed how you build your life. We sing a song called Build Your Life. Take heed how you build your life. No other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become clear. For the day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire. And the fire will test each one's work, of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on, it endures, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through the fire. Do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the temple of God dwells in you? If anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him, for the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. We see here that even to Apollos and different forefathers of the faith, even apostles, they laid a foundation. It is God that gives the increase. And it says that the work that you do, here's the reality is this. Jesus says this in John 15, verse 16, you did not choose me, I chose you and called you for a purpose. Brothers and sisters, if you are born again, God called you to go to work for his kingdom. Can someone say amen on that? Amen. He called you to go to work for his kingdom for a purpose. And everything you do for the Lord will be tested before the judgment seat of Christ. It will be tested by fire. All the works that you do in this life, everything you do in this life, brothers and sisters, believers, because I'm talking to you, because you're going to be the ones standing before the judgment seat of Christ. Your salvation is paid for. You can stand with no condemnation, but everything you do as unto the Lord will last for an eternity. Everything you do for the Lord, even today, you got up out of bed. You went through the rainstorms and you came to church today and you came to hear the word. I'm telling you, what you did today will be there forever. Wow, think about that. What you didn't do today will be burned by fire. In other words, do you really think the extra million that you worked hard to attain in this life, when you stand before the judgment seat of Christ and is tested by American money, is going to be, are you going to take American money and you're going to offer it to the king? And when it's tested by fire, what do you think you got? It'll be worth less than our government even says it is. A little worth even less. In other words, it will be gone, right? You know, when a church has $1 million in its account and it's scared to death to spend it, do you really think, church, we're going to offer that million to the Lord? And what's it going to be worth? Think about it. If we can invest that million into the kingdom and we offer a soul, if we spend $1 million, church, and one soul was won, that's worth it. Can someone say amen? Amen. Whoa, that was kind of weak. You think, oh man, one soul, pastor? How about 100? I mean, after all, we invested $1 million. That $1 million in the eternal mindset is going to be burnt. It's what you did with it you will give an account for. We as a church, but you know what? You individually will too. You will give an account. God says, I gave you abilities. You made a living. You did quite well. I promised you food and clothing, but you forsake the house of God. You didn't give your tithes and offerings, and all that money you accumulated means nothing to me. Nothing to me. Tried by fire. Now, the things you did for the kingdom, everything. You opened the door for someone as unto the Lord. You met at the door. As I mentioned last week, Jimmy meets people at the door every week. That's an eternal investment. Even the money you gave to the king is an eternal investment. Why do we hoard it so much? What we give to him, the time that you give to the king, the efforts you make. Maybe even today what we've seen, first you're here, but even the praise team that got up earlier today, and they got up and they made it here today no matter what, no matter how they felt, and the tech people that also do every week. Do you realize that's an eternal investment? Eternal investment. The musicians that played today, those that were here today, that's an eternal. Everything you do, it's for an eternity. But the things you do, if you miss being a part of and using your giftings for the Lord. If you don't use your giftings, if you aren't, like, for example, Brother Space mows the lawn faithfully, and you thought it just miraculously stayed mowed. It's pretty amazing, isn't it? Every time he does that, he's doing it to the Lord. And that's eternally there. And his works, our works, your works, will be tried by fire. Anything you ever did for the king, when it's tried by the fire, when you give to the glory of God, it will remain. It will remain. But also says here, God will destroy anyone who destroys this temple. For God's temple is holy, and you're a temple. Did you know what responsibility, this tent that God's given us to take care of it? We have a responsibility. Did you know anytime you abuse it, it says God holds you accountable for that too? How do we abuse it? This is where I can really get in trouble. We can look at, drugs, alcohol, cigarettes, and marijuana, and how about overeating? How about not getting enough sleep? How about, Pastor, we don't talk about those things. Hey, if we don't take care of ourselves, did you know we have a responsibility to take care of ourselves? God gave us a temple that we are to take care of and better manage, and he holds us accountable for that. How? I don't know. But I do know we're going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and everything will be evaluated. Let's go to another scripture, and that's actually in Luke 19. I told you to turn there. Luke 19, verse 11. Do a little scripture reading today, which is a good thing. Verse 11. Luke 19, 11. I'm reading from the New King James, by the way. So if you have other versions, every once in a while I'll tell you what verse I'm in. Now, as they heard these things, he spoke another parable because he was near Jerusalem and because they thought the kingdom of God, the series is called Your Kingdom Come, they thought that the kingdom of God would appear immediately. Therefore, he said, a certain nobleman went to a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. So he called 10 of his servants, delivered to them 10 minas, and said to them, do business till I come. But his citizens hated him and sent a delegation after him, saying, we will not have this man reign over us. There's a whole world around us that says, God, you will not rule over us. It's amazing. Verse 15, and so it was that when he returned, having received the kingdom, he then commanded these servants to whom he had given the money to be called to him, that he might know how much every man had gained by trading. Then came the first, saying, Master, your mina has earned 10 minas. And he said, well done, good servant, because you are faithful in a very little and have authority over 10 cities. So it seems to indicate that rewards will be rewards in our future kingdom. We're going to talk about the millennial reign of Christ, and it'll be rewards that we have even over various cities. And the second came, saying, Master, your mina has earned 5 minas. Likewise, he said, you also be over 5 cities. Then another came, saying, Master, here is your mina, which I have kept, but put away in a handkerchief. For I feared you, because you are an austere man. You collect what you did not deposit and reap what you did not sow. And he said to him, out of your own mouth I will judge you, you wicked servant. You knew that I was an austere man, collecting what I did not deposit and reaping what I did not sow. Why then did you not put my money in the bank, that at my coming I might collected it with interest? And he said to those who stood by, take the mina from him and give it to him who has 10 minas. But they said to him, Master, he has 10 minas. For I say to you that everyone who has will be given, and from him who does not have, even what he has will be taken from him. but bring here those enemies of mine who did not want me to reign over them and slay them before me. Here we see a parable that's talking along the same lines we're mentioning, that you are held accountable for everything God gives you. He is the one, the kingdom. He's the king of the kingdom. His kingdom is now, the church, and his kingdom is coming in the millennial reign. Everything he gives you, think about this, you are accountable to him. But what could that mean, Pastor? That could mean your abilities. Some of you have abilities and giftings, mercy that are beyond other people, and you ought to be exhibiting that. Some of you have the means of making money. Did you know that's a great gift, but then that also is accountable, meaning you also have a responsibility to give back to the king. Can someone say amen on that? Maybe some of you have the ability to sing glory to God, and he's given you a special ability. You have a responsibility to do that, to use it. Maybe some of you have technical skills that you have, and that's greatly needed in the world today, even in the church world. And if you're not using them, you're going to be held accountable for that. That's why we encourage you as a church, get involved. Use your ministries. It's not just because, oh, the pastor needs it. No. It's about you will be blessed eternally for doing it. Can someone say amen? Everything you do, let this soak in, because we take this for granted. God gives us giftings and abilities. You have them. If you're not sure what they are, you need to be researching them, because they're there. God says, I have the right, as your king, to expect things from you. Even says here, even if you have one gift, he said the least you can do is put it in the bank and draw interest on it. He expects you to grow. He expects you to grow and do something. And not just work, because he has the right to ask you that, but he will reward you before the judgment seat of Christ. I'm convinced that the judgment seat of Christ, I can't fathom just what it's like, just what it looks like. You know, I do know that Jesus Christ is the judge, and I know it's going to be glorious. It's called the Bema seat, and it's also like a step up. It's a place where the judge sits. There again, I want to stress this, believers, that there is no condemnation there for you. Only thing that you are judged on is the things that you do for the kingdom. For the kingdom. And your works will be tried by fire. And I'm convinced that there will be people that just got saved, that were just born again before the rapture, and they're ushered before the great white throne. And my visual, and I'm a very visual-minded person, you know, I can visualize a person standing there, and their works are tried by fire. And they've had a whole life of not living for the Lord, but praise God he saved them, right? And he stands there, this fire comes, this is my visual. You can have this visual, and if you don't, that's my dream. So a fire comes, and I could just see them standing there and basically stark naked, have nothing but themselves to offer the king. Are they saved? Yes. But they have no rewards for the king. They have nothing to offer him. They've done nothing for the kingdom. There will be those that are saved in the last moment. But my friend, if you've been saved for any length of time, if you've been born again, what are you doing for the kingdom? How are you serving your king? We've just read he's a righteous king and he is the judge, and your works will be evaluated. Even says here, the one who had one gift, one talent, one minus. He gave him one and did nothing with it. And he said, I'm going to remove that from you. I'm going to give it to the ones that are doing something. I'm convinced that if we don't use our talents, God can literally remove them. He'll say, hey, brother, if you have this ability, you have this ability, and if you don't use it, And then you're not living peaceful before God because you're not serving your king. And he'll say, I'll remove that. I'm going to give it to someone who will do it. I believe that that happens in churches where a church does nothing but go to church, go home, and does nothing for the kingdom. I believe he removes his lamp. You read about that in Revelation 2 and 3. He removes the light from the church and says, I'm going to give it to someone who will do something. Hey, let us be not just lighthouse in name, let us be a lighthouse in our community. A bunch of people that are doing something. Can someone say amen? Amen. Wow, that was weak. A bunch of people that are doing something for the king. Can someone say amen?
Amen.
As a church, but as individuals too. And here's the reality, saints. The judgment seat of Christ is the place all of us will stand. And sis, every time you played the piano unto the Lord, every time the tech or singing, sis, and I would like to say names, but we're recording this live stream. Everything you do, even today, you got out of bed and you came to church. That has eternal rewards. I don't want to be one of those people that is standing there basically stark naked and got me to give the king. I want to be one of those people that I have a visual of a wheelbarrow. It's like you're standing there with a wheelbarrow before the king. Here's the rewards that are yours. Tried by fire, and this is remaining. My wheelbarrow, not just my, I pray our wheelbarrow be full. And we offer it to the king. Right? What are you doing for the kingdom? Because this message is for you individually, because each one of us individually, I will have to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. I'm going there. If you're a believer, you're going there. It happens at the rapture when we're ushered before the Lord. I want to go and say, Lord of Lords, King of Kings, here's the things you gave me. I preached your word. I sang unto you. I did this, that. I'm not listing off my stuff. I'm listing off all of us. I was faithful what you did, you gave me. And I want to give that to the king. If you are here today and you're doing nothing for the kingdom, you've done nothing for the kingdom, my friend, you may be saved, but man, I'd be embarrassed for you. Did you just say that? Yeah, I would be. And I'm not saying that how great I am. I'm not saying that. I'm saying, my word, what are you doing? Because you'll offer it to the king. And all those efforts you're doing in this world that doesn't involve and give glory to Christ, it's just going to be gone. Gone. It's almost like if you want to offer your money to the king, he's going to say, have you seen behind me? The streets are gold. I mean, do you think I need your... No. I need you. I need you. And it's clear that he will evaluate us. You will be judged by the righteous judgment. And if you're saved, there is no condemnation before the judgment seat of Christ, but there is evaluation. And everything you've done for the king lasts forever. That ought to be encouraging too. Maybe there's people that you helped through the years that you reached out to as unto the Lord, and they didn't give you the time of day. They didn't, you know, there's those that maybe you reached out to and they literally spit in your face and walk off. And you're like, oh, I'm discouraged. Be encouraged. Why? Because whatever you do, Jesus sees. And it's works of gold, silver. Every meal you fix, sis, every time you do it as unto the Lord, you're doing it to the Lord. And every time, that's an eternal reward. Eternal. That changes how we do things, doesn't it? It takes it from discouragement to encouragement. Because even if that person you help, as unto the Lord, if they turn and they spit in your face and walk off, you still did it as unto the Lord, and Jesus sees it. And we'll remember that for an eternity. My friend, I pray, even today, that's going to be our prayer. Everyone here will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. I pray that we all do. Because if you don't stand there, you're going to stand before the great white throne. My friend, you do not want to go there. Well, how do I stop them going there, Pastor? You've said there's two thrones, and you're going to be judged. You talk about the judgment seat of Christ. You talk about the great white throne we're going to talk about in the next few weeks. And you say, don't go there. How do I make sure I go here? Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Surrender. Surrender. What do you mean? Say, Lord, I need you. I repent of my sins. I'm sorry for the things I've done. Lord Jesus, forgive me. Come into my heart. I confess you, but I will confess you before all men. You are my Lord. I will serve you. I will take your gifts you've given me, and I'm going to do something about it. And he will forever reign. He will wipe the slate clean. And there will be no more condemnation. And you will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. But your works will be evaluated and tried by fire. Hey, saints, you ready to go? You ready to go? It's going to be amazing. I want to see Jesus. I want to see him. Amen. In all his glory. In all his glory, his purity. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, you are so good. God, I pray for victory. I pray, Lord, that if there's anyone here that does not know you, has not been born again, that they would receive you into their heart and mind. They would repent of their sins and confess you as Lord. But Lord, even today, as we as believers, we have the realization that we will stand before you. We're speaking to you right now that we will stand before you. And our works will be evaluated. Oh God, let us have great things to offer the King. Let our works of gold, silver, and precious metals last for an eternity. Let us honor you and praise you. And we as a church, Father, I pray that we would serve you, that we would be a light that you pray. I pray that you do not remove your candlestick from here, that we would burn brightly. Lord, I thank you for your mercy. And Lord, I thank you for the guarantee of your Spirit in our hearts and minds. Let us honor you and praise you. And we do love you, God, as a body, your body. And we are a bride waiting for your coming. We love you, Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I believe we're going to sing At the Cross. At the Cross, where the old song is where I first saw the light. But Chris Tomlin has a neat spin on it. Beautiful song. But the point is, it's at the cross that we see the light. At the cross we see Christ because he paid the price we couldn't pay. Praise God, we have no condemnation, but we are saved, we are born again, and that we will stand before the judgment seat. Take all the rewards, and I pray you've got your wheelbarrow full. I pray, matter of fact, maybe you've seen a dump truck and just backing up there, and you hear the beep, beep, beep backing up there. I pray God has to get a dump truck for your rewards. And they can bring it there, and they will last for an eternity. Don't be one of those people that got nothing but the shirt on your back to present the King. Do something for the kingdom of God. Honor him and praise him. Be victorious. Be grateful for the price that's paid for you at the cross.
There's
where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the a flood come flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you. I'm in awe of you. Where your love to you, I owe all to you. And here my hope is found, here on holy ground, here I bow down, here I bow. Open wide here, you saved my life. Here I bow down, here I bow at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you, I'm in awe of you. Where your love, my sin.